Good afternoon, my dear students. I am going to start class today. Yesterday, we could not able to continue because of the some issues of technical, and I am not able to upload the files properly, and also I am not able to explain it the problems which are. I may quickly go through that and whatever the information which I have given. I did not make any justification previously. I'll go through once again all the problem for the information. Those who are not regular to the class, also you can see that the problem which I started solving right from this iron plate problem which I solved, and this is how the this is how the Fourier's number and Biot number. This is the Biot number line 0.288. 0.088, and this is the temperature distribution equation you are going to get as shown in page number 66 of your data and book, that is Kodan Raman, and I solved from that book. This is Fourier number is equal to 3.1. here I have to take, that's clearly I shown that, and after taking this 3.1, and when you go right line perpendicular to the base of this Fourier line, whatever the axis which I shown here, the Fourier's dimension value is shown here like this on the axis, x-axis, and y-axis it is temperature distribution. The curve is plotted for that is a Biot number. Okay, this Biot number value is 0.3, 0.2. It is showing here 0.2. Okay, this is the 0.2 line that I am going to take. So from this Fourier is equal to 3.1, I am where it intercept. From that point you have to draw horizontal line towards the left, and till it reaches the temperature distribution line on y-axis, that value is 0.58. See, it is 0.58 to take this 0.6, 0.7, 0.8, 0.9, and 1. So this is the temperature distribution line. From this, you have to calculate. And another thing is, there are three graphs which I shown. All the three are plotted. Look at here. This is the first page number 66. This is the problem which I given. Biot number is calculated 0.21. 1 by Biot is 4.8. And then I calculated Fourier number 3.1. And from the Biot number and Fourier number, you can calculate the temperature distribution by plotting the graph like this. That is equal to 0.58. From this, you can calculate 141. That is the temperature at the center of the slab T naught after 2 minutes time. Okay, then the position temperature at any position you can take. So this is how I taken. This graph is over. Position value, the x by L value calculated. X by L value is 0.6. So x by value, this is the x by value lines. These are the lines of x by L value. This is temperature distribution line. This is Biot number. Okay, and x-axis Biot number, and y-axis the temperature distribution, and x by L value is given like this. So on the point for 0.6 is 0.6 line is here. Okay, that 0.6 line you are going to take, and Fourier Biot number is equal to 0.6, not 0.6. I think 0.28, 0.088. So from point, at least you can 0.21. You can take a dry line vertically upward, and there where it intersect the x by L value as 0.6, and then plot it here, you will get the temperature distribution that is equal to almost 0.95 or something. So here I have taken the 0.95. So here I have shown the right side, I have shown the graph, how I have taken the temperature distribution graph. You have to draw vertical line at Biot number is equal to 0.21, and then where it intersect the x by L value is equal to 0.6. From that you can take the temperature distribution line. So again you substitute, and after once at a position, at whatever the specified position you take, an x by L, so there you get the temperature as 132.5. that is the temperature I got calculated. Okay, heat loss from the plate per square meter including both sides during the transient up to time 2 is equal to 2 minutes, it is determined as follows. First you have to take Biot number square and Fourier, multiply this, you get 0.3 0.137. So this is the value that you are going to take, and then Byatt number and Byatt square into 4 year number value one, that is 0.2. These two values, we are going to take the these two values. This is one value, another value is this. Okay, for this you are going to take the non-dimensional heat transfer equation that you are going to take. That is first is Q naught MCP delta T, and that is how you have taken that. It is by the known component and temperature you are going to calculate this. So what is Q by Q naught value? Q by Q naught means this is the Byatt square into 4 year, that comes to around some value. From that you have to draw a vertical line where it intersect with the Byatt number. From that you have to draw horizontal line, horizontal to the x-axis, where it intersect, that value become Q by Q naught is equal to 0.45. So from that you are calculating this. I think last class I made an attempt to resolve this problem, but because of the file could not upload it, and I'm doing it now. So this is another problem, and those who are referring some different data and book, this is how it's going to be shown: Heisler chart and Grover chart. There are three types of charts are there. The data and book which you are referring, it is only Byatt number is plotted. Some books have plotted one by Byatt in order to accommodate the graphs in a very precise manner on the log graphs. Okay. This is again the temperature of this distribution, and already explained in the last class. So these are things already I explained to you. This is the third time explaining. I'll go to the problem. I think there is a network problem again. I'll refresh it once again and see that. These are the graphs which I have given for the long cylinder, and these are the graphs which I have given for sphere. Temperature history graph at the center, and this is the temperature history, temperature time history at radius R, and also it is a heat flow through sphere, and I am going to solve a few problem on long cylinder and sphere also. So this is one more problem. If the data is not given, the material property data is not given, then you have to refer page number 1 and 2 of data and book. That is, Kodan Raman book, page number 1 and 2, different material. And if the conductivity is given, you have to take back the, according to the conductivity, you take back the material, the diffusivity, and the conductivity and temperature. There are three temperatures are given, they ask you to find out the initial temperature. That is after the time lapse of determine the time required to access cylinder to attain the temperature of 136. It means the temperature. It is very simple problem. Simple problem. It can be solved like this. First, you have to calculate the Biot number, and then you have to calculate the Fourier number, and then from this you can Biot number and Fourier number. You can plot from Fourier number, go to a Biot number of 2.04. And then plot the temperature. Temperature distribution, you will get 0.3. From this 0.3, you can also calculate. Either way, you can do it. So one is the temperature distribution, because all the four temperatures he has given. See, look at here. This is the temperature distribution is 0.3. And from this, you can calculate the Fourier number by using temperature distribution and also the Biot number. You can take this and then calculate the Fourier number. From Fourier number, you can calculate the time. This time you can calculate. Okay, time calculation you can do it. That is 184 degrees Celsius. This very simple problem he has given. Go to the next problem, the aluminium cylinder of radius 10 cm, which is initially at uniform temperature of 350 degrees Celsius. It is suddenly exposed to an environment at 30 degrees Celsius. The convection heat transfer coefficient between cylinder and surface and the environment is 600 watt per meter square Kelvin. Calculate the temperature at radius of 6 cm and heat transfer per meter length of the cylinder is 120 seconds. After the cylinder is exposed to the environment, so these are the properties which are taken from the data handbook. The data handbook page number is 1 and 1.2. You can take from that and then note down all the values, that is the thermal conductivity, diffusivity and density and specific heat at constant pressure. You can take down all these values. After taking this, I got one more graph. 1 minute. So again, there is a internet issue. I don't know. There is a break. It is getting break between. And this is one type of Grover chart. That is Heisler and Grover chart. And it is what he has plotted is, he has plotted the lines. These are the Biot number lines. This is 4 year. These are the values of 4 year. And these are the values for temperature distribution. This is one type of graph. So this is a determination of loss of temperature and radius, ratio of, and this graph at radius R naught, this graph is used to calculate the temperature distribution as well as similar graph, but some student may refer this also, because in other data handbook, other than whatever conventional data handbook you are using, and you are getting this Grover chart. Using this chart also, I have solved some few problems. Okay, this is a problem which I solved using that Grover chart. So first I calculated the Biot number. I'll get back to the problem. This is the problem which I am going there, and this is the one, the temperature time history center temperature I have taken here. Same problem can be solved in two ways. First, I calculated the Fourier number is equal to 1.1, Biot number is 3.4, or R by R naught is 0.6, Biot number is 0.3 I have taken. So it means different values I have taken. Determine the temperature at the axis of the cylinder being a Heisler chart. Okay, that's a Heisler and Grover chart. We call that both as Hazel and Roper chart. By using temperature history and Fourier, using all the three, you can calculate the temperature distribution. So this is one type, and you will get the temperature distribution for this 0.64. Okay, or else directly you can take from this graph. See, this is the Fourier temperature, and the Biot number is there. From that, you can calculate the temperature distribution that comes to around 0.60. This is a simple method, the conventional method which I have followed. I am following that. Okay, other method is using this graph also you can solve, but it is a little cumbersome, and you not have to refer that. You can directly refer this, because sometimes the problem may be asked on that. But directly you will get 0.6.04, the temperature distribution that I have taken here. What is that? 6.045, this value. Eliminating all these procedures, only selecting Fourier number and Biot number, you can directly get this. Okay, so after that you can get the dimensionless heat transfer. Okay, how we are going to calculate this value? So you already know the Biot number and Fourier number. Fourier square into Biot, you can take this value, and then 3.0 is there. Like this, there is a middle point I have taken. This is a graph which you are going to take, and you will get the temperature, this one flow, that is the non-dimensional heat flow equation, that is 0.38 from Hazler chart. So this is how the value is taken. And finally, we are going to calculate, eliminating all this procedure, directly we are going to get this one, directly you get 223. Okay, after calculating the Fourier into Biot square, you will get 0.08. It means 0.1 you can take, 0.1, and using Biot number, this from Hazler charts, you will get Q by Q0 is equal to 0.38 at this value. It means that is why I mentioned at these two value, this can be taken. But for unit length, how much is the heat loss he has asked. Therefore, unit length is Q by L, rho Cp by L. LL get cancelled, you get rho Cp, that is MCP delta T, you can apply rho Cp into the area pi r square, r naught square, substitute all the values, you get 24.38 megajoule. Hence the heat transfer per unit length of the cylinder is, multiply this ratio with whatever the Q naught value you got. Q naught value is this. This is the Q naught value multiplied by 0.38, that is the ratio of a non-dimensional heat flow. You can get 9.26 megajoule per minute. In 2 minutes, you can calculate this if you are familiar with using the Hazler charts, Hazler and Roper chart. So coming to the steel sphere of radius 10 centimeter, which is insulated at a uniform temperature of 630 degrees Celsius, is suddenly immersed in an oil bath at 30 degrees Celsius with a convection heat transfer coefficient of 500 watt per meter square Kelvin. How long will it take for a center of the sphere to reach a temperature of 90 degrees Celsius? Okay, solution, the data given, we know that a steel property is not given. You can directly go to page number 1 in the data handbook, or page number 2. You can take conductivity is equal to 54 and density alpha, that is diffusivity, that you can take and then start solving the problem. The temperatures are given. T naught is 90 degree, T infinity 30, and T at a point after certain period, it is 630. It means it's asking you how long it will take a center temperature reach a sphere of 90 degrees. Take, it means time you have to calculate, how much time it will take when it is exposed to the environment. Therefore, you can calculate the Biot number, HR0 by K. So 1 by Biot, you will get 1.8. From using Hazler charts, you will get Fourier's number by temperature distribution of 0.1. Fourier's number is equal to 1.125. From that you can calculate the time. That is time period is 7632 seconds. From Fourier you can directly calculate the time. So this is the time calculation we are going to do. So substituting alpha and R naught square, you can divide it by alpha square. You can substitute here. Directly you can get temperature. Sorry, time t in seconds, that can be converted into hours. That is this divided by 3600, you'll get hours. That is 2.12 hours. Okay, this is how I taken that. So these two graphs are plotted for. This is another graph, and this one is I taken, and then that graph, this graph I have not taken because it is belongs to the mid plane of infinite plate and mid plane of long cylinder, mid plane of sphere. These are the some of the graphs used for calculating the temperature distribution and heat flow and position after such a lapse of time, what is the temperature. So these are the graphs. One more problem I am going to solve. So this steel sphere of radius 6 cm, which is initially at a uniform temperature of 325 degrees Celsius, is suddenly exposed to an environment of 25 degree with a convection heat transfer coefficient of 500 watt per meter square Kelvin. Calculate the temperature at a radius of 3.6 cm and heat transfer in 100 second after the sphere is exposed to environment. It means whether it is cooling or heating. When it is a heating, this is the heating problem, because it is exposed to environment and allow it for cooling. Okay, this problem can be conveniently solved by using Heisler's chart represented. And first let us determine the center temperature by knowing the property of steel. So what steel you are going to take depend on the conductivity. That is 54 is the conductivity which I selected. Based on that you can take the diffusivity, density and specific heat. From that you can calculate the first Biot number. Biot number is equal to 0.555 you get. So this graph I used to solve that problem, but I also attempted using the graph which are given. The problem is solved according to that graph only, but you can also solve by using the graphs which are given, page number 66. It is 74 and 75 and 76. These are the page number and the graphs are given on that page by say Kodan Raman book. You can take that. Directly you can go Fourier's and Biot number, you can calculate the temperature distribution. That is equal to 0.63 you get. From this you can also obtain temperature. Directly you can take instead of going for this, you can calculate. Directly you can go to this step and then do the calculation by substituting the values. It is equal to 0.63. Whatever the previous graph which I shown, the temperature time history graph you will take. From that, using Fourier number and Biot number, you can take down the temperature distribution line of 0.63 and calculate the temperature. Hence the temperature at a radius R is equal to 3 cm and time of 100 second, it is equal to 214 degree Celsius. Again you calculate for non-dimensional heat flow. This is the non-dimensional heat. By using Fourier's into Biot square, you can calculate that is equal to 0.16. By using Biot number and this number, you can take the heat flow ratio is equal to 0.45. By taking these two values, this value and Biot number from the graph, third graph, that is heat flow ratio graph, you can take like this. And you can calculate, again you have to go for MCP. Delta T, that is MCP delta T, so mass is the volume into density gives the mass, and CP value substitute, that is the volume is pi by 4 by 3 pi r square and temperature difference is given. Substituting these values you will get the amount of heat flow in kilojoules. So q by q naught is equal to 0.45, and multiplying that q naught, you can get the temperature in terms of megajoule, because 10 raised to 6 can be written as megajoule. You can also calculate like this. So the number of problems you can solve similar to this. You can also go to many problems. The exam problem also you can take. You can solve those problems by using Hazler chart, simple transient. And you are lucky enough that you don't have a semi-infinite solids. Semi-infinite solids and non-dimensional numbers that you are using. It means those are eliminated from the syllabus. And you are lucky enough to have only the Hazler and Grober chart for solving this problem. Okay. What my syllabus is going to be get completed. Another maximum 1 hour I can take. But thing is that whatever the topic which I covered, explained, the students who are missing this class, I may repeat all the topics in another 4 class I left out to complete. I once again will take up all the topics which I covered, right from the modes of heat transfer till the transient heat conduction, including fins and also the composite walls. That I am going to repeat once again. Those who have missed those classes, they can also come and attend. And all my lectures are given to the regional office at VTO Mysore. You can also take and then refer it. Any problem is there, you can approach through my mail ID or send queries to the regional office. They are going to in turn correspond it to me. So this is how the only three things you are going to calculate. One is a temperature history, position after giving the time, and also the amount of heat flow. It means whenever the body is getting cooled or heated, how much time it will take, what position you want to know the temperature, and how much heat is going to be get dissipated, or how much it is going to be get accumulated or absorbed by the body. That you are going to. And only another problem, iron sphere of conductivity is C. Look at this. The problems which are going to be asked in the examination are like this. If I don't give the data, the students are allowed to take any data. Means that this individual student will randomly pick some data, because iron sphere is given. What type of iron? Is it a stainless steel or it is a magnesium ferroalloy? Or I'm going to give the data and book and I'm show you how the material is taken. Go to the page number 2 for property value of metal at 20 degree or as indicated he has given. So at 20 degree means normal temperature, and here carbon steel, chromium steel. Carbon steel with 1% chromium, 5%, 20%, 15% to 25%, and copper pure, like that magnesium pure, magnesium steel, nickel pure, nickel steel, silver, silica steel, stainless steel, like that he has given. This is two pages here given, page number 2 and 3, both are belong to, but unless otherwise it is specified in the problem, you may not get uniform answer for values. And values have become very difficult to evaluate the student answers. For that, the examiner has to give the properties so that the student can able to calculate the whatever the time period, whatever the position, temperature he asked, all that. Okay. So for this problem I given, and the previous problem I selected my own data and then I done that problem. So see, the diameter of the sphere is 5 cm and its properties are given in the bracket. Is initially at uniform temperature of 225. It means it is at existing temperature of 225. When it suddenly surface is exposed to the ambient temperature of 25, it means from 225 degree to sphere is taken out and exposed to the 25 degree with the heat transfer coefficient of fluid is 500 watts per meter square degree Celsius. First thing is calculate the center temperature of the time t is equal to 2 minutes after the start of the cooling. Second, the on the question is, as is, calculate the temperature at 1 centimeter from the surface, time t is equal to 2 minutes. Same problem I applied for the slab, same problem I taken for sphere. See how the answer is going to vary. Calculate the energy removed from the sphere during this time. It means how much heat is transferred from sphere to the surrounding at 2 minutes time. You have to calculate. Solution: the problem is identical to the considered example of 4.4 except the geometry. Already given here 4.4. I have solved this problem, but except the geometry is the sphere. Instead of metal slab, I have taken sphere. Transient temperature can be used to solve this problem. So the sphere temperature, spherical temperature graph can be used. Instead of slab, we can use. So temperature of 1 centimeter from the surface is determined by calculating the R by R naught ratio and 1 by Baat. From that, you can take the temperature distribution directly and then calculate the temperature is equal to 59.2 degrees Celsius. The heat loss directly you can take Baat square and Fourier number, and these two values, from these two values you can calculate the temperature ratio. So this one value and another value is this 0.37. Using these two values you can also calculate the third value by the graph. So after getting this non-dimensional heat flow, and Q naught is equal to mcp delta T, again multiply density by volume 4 by 3 pi r cube into temperature difference, you'll get the heat flow in terms of joule. 47,268 joule of heat is lost after exposing from 225 degree the sphere to atmospheric of 25 degree. So this heat loss can be substituted in the dimensional heat flow ratio Q by Q naught. Q naught is known, and you can calculate Q is equal to 0.84 Q naught. You will get this in terms of joule. Okay. Revision for conduction heat transfer. So I can go for revision now without wasting much time, because in 4 class left out, I have to revise everything. And I did a some exam problem they added into the revision problems, so that I can take up that for analysis. So give me 1 minute time, I'll reload the file. I started my class at on 12th. Last month. So this is the syllabus which I covered. I am making a revision of whatever the topic I covered in the first class. Introduction, concept and definition, modes of heat transfer, basic law governing conduction, convection and radiation heat transfer, thermal conductivity, convective heat transfer coefficient, radiation heat transfer, combined heat transfer mechanism, types of boundary condition, general heat conduction equation, derivation of equation, steady state, one dimensional and conduction problems, Cartesian system. This is the module 1 and it's very simple. Module 2, the steady state, one dimensional heat conduction, problem 1 without heat generation, with and without varying thermal conductivity in Cartesian system with various possible boundary condition. Thermal resistance is resistance in series and in parallel that you have to study. So this is module 1. This module 2 is critical thickness of insulation, concept, derivation, extended surface or fins, classification, straight and rectangular and circular fins, temperature distribution and heat transfer calculations, fin efficiency and effectiveness, applications of transient and steady state heat conduction, definition, different cases of this transient heat conduction, negligible internal thermal resistance, negligible surface resistance, comparable with internal thermal resistance and surface resistance, lumped body, numerical example, Heisler and Grover chart, introduction to numerical analysis of the heat conduction. So numerical analysis is there. It is only introduction. That part I am going to take it after the revision is over. Okay, this is module 3. Somebody will going to take this after my lecture, module 4 and module 5. So these are the textbook I specified: Principal Heat Transfer of Frank Rith, Eunice Senegal and Hallman. These are the Magrell publications, and this is Senes learning from the Frank Rithby's book from that. And these two books are from Magrell publications. And which book I referred is the Frank Rith and Ozasik. Part of it is Hallman I referred. And also he has given the reference book, Heat Transfer by Kurt C. Rolle, second edition, Senes Learning. And Heat Transfer by Nakati Ozasik and the Basic Approach by Magrell, New York, 2005. Fundamentals of Heat and Mass Transfer, Incopera FP and D. White DP, 5th edition, Jan Willis edition of New York, 2006. And Hallman, there is one more Magrell publication books. So these are the reference, that is the reference books, and these are the web references that he has given. Heat Transfer by, it's very difficult to go through all this unless you have a basic knowledge of understanding the heat transfer. Okay, these are the syllabus mentioned topics that I am going to cover. These are the abbreviations that are going to be used in the entire heat transfer. Coming to the introductory concept and definition, study of heat transfer mechanism is very important for engineering who are in the field of design, construction, testing and also heat exchanger equipments. See, the mechanical engineers deals with the problems of heat transfer in the field of IC engines, steam generation and use of refrigerator air conditioning. Also, the chemical engineering concerned with the evaporator, condenser and melting or cooking various fluids. And civil engineer deals with the heat transfer during construction of dams, structure and buildings. See, all engineers need to understand the heat transfer. Why I am telling you is that if the concrete is and huge mass of concrete is mixed and then poured at one location, you know, the roads and bridges are constructed, even the metro line they are constructing, big pillars have been, they are going to cast overnight. And if the proper ventilation is not given to the amount of heat generated because of mixing the cement, cement is maximum, lime is there. Lime will react with water and then release exothermic reaction and release lot of heat. That heat should be properly dissipated to the atmosphere. Otherwise, it may create crack in the concrete. Later, the stability of the structure is going to be vanished. The proper ventilation or ventilation should be given, or you have to allow the concrete to cool and slowly you have to pour it. So the chemical engineers also, they design evaporator, condenser, mixtures and multiple cooking systems for where to use the chemical is, means manufacturing beverage, maybe they are using it, and process industries like pulp manufacturers, food manufacturers, all are using the heat transfer. Mechanical engineers major deal with the heat transfer in the field of IC engine, steam generation and turbines, and also refrigeration air conditioning, and also the precast moldings and boilers and the furnitures. The furnace, the melting furnace also they are using heat transfer, and the wall thickness also they are going to be calculated. Similarly, many construction engineers also involved in that. All engineers need to understand, even electronics engineers to know the how the electrical engineers, electronics engineers and engineers who have apply their knowledge for the heat transfer, the cooling system, motor and generators. Details of heat transfer analysis is necessary to estimate the cost and feasibility and size of the equipment necessary to transfer the specified amount of the heat which is given in time. It means the best example is IC engine. You are running IC engine, that is a car engine. It is in the mounted on a chassis and then you are running that engine. The amount of heat generated in the car, it should not be, if it is not properly taken out, the thermal efficiency is going to be lost. It means the more the heat that you generate, the amount of heat generated is get converted into useful work. The balance amount is going to the exhaust, and the whatever the heat conducted out through the engine, it is absorbed by the radiators, and thereby the engine perform well. So this is what you have to learn. It means one or the other. Engineers are involved in calculating this. Okay. See, any successful operation of component is required. You have to optimum temperature you have to maintain. Suppose the turbine is running, refrigerator is running, it is not properly cooled, and it's going to be the loss of lubrications is going to happen because of the high temperature. Lubricant will withstand only up to 180 to 200 degree. After that, the lubrication is also oil, which is going to give frictionless motion between the two contact surfaces. They're going to be get operated. If the properly, so the rubbing surface are not properly lubricated, then you are going to have a more amount of heat getting generated. Two melts are cause a frictional welding. It means they, you call it as a seizure. It means two metal get fused together very high temperature. It means you need to remove the heat continuously, or you need to add the heat continuously to any of the system. Okay. And these are the some of the most useful heat transfer encountered cannot be solved by thermodynamic reasoning only. Any heat transfer cannot be solved by only by giving thermodynamics reasoning. It means system and surrounding. The first law of thermodynamics, the amount of heat, that is cyclic integral of heat is equal to cyclic integral of work. It means the heat is directly converted into work. It's not possible like that. You need to understand the heat transfer as a topic of, though it is a topic of thermodynamics, thermodynamics reasoning alone insufficient to analyze the heat transfer problems. That is why you need some basic fundamental differential equation to solve the given problem. The basic modes of heat transfer can be defined as a transfer of energy from one region to another region as a result of temperature difference between them. The phenomenon of heat transfer is as universal as those associated with the gravitational attraction, since the difference in temperature exists all over the universe. You must have seen that the temperature difference exists in all over the universe means the equatorial, the temperature is more as you go to the pole, whether northern pole or southern pole, temperature keep on decreasing. I know this causes the very huge temperature difference. And also, always the wind start blowing from one direction to other direction. It is because of the change in the density of the air. Okay, cooling loses the density of air and increases the density of air. Heating loses the density of the air. So when the air is getting heated up and it moves fast to the sky in the upward direction, and there it is getting cooled and then again go to some other direction and set in a sort of a cyclone. It means a complete ring, it means circulation start from one location to other location. This circulation diameter is usually minimum of 600 to 1000 kilometers. So this causes the wind to blow with change in the density of the fluid. This is again by convection principle. So there are three different modes of heat transfer. One is conduction, convection and radiation. All these three modes of heat transfer have in common temperature. It means what is common in all the three, convection, conduction, convection, radiation, heat transfer. What is common is that temperature difference is common. It means temperature gradient is common. Difference between the source and system is common. So that is how if the temperature difference, if it is not existing, there is no heat transfer at all. It become almost stable. It means no flow of heat taking place between them. it means become a, it reaches a steady state. We call it as a steady state. There are two words frequently that you are using. One is a steady state condition, another one is unsteady state condition. When it becomes a steady state, there is no change. Unsteady, it means it's continuously keep on changing position and time you are counting. So, okay, conduction heat pulse, steady state I am going to take up now. The conduction heat transfer, which is the law which governs the phenomena of conduction, the named after a mathematician, that is Joseph Fourier, a popularly known as Fourier's law of conduction. Fourier's law of conduction, usually Fourier's law of thermal conduction is used to call, because thermal means heat, heat is going to be get conducted. The Fourier law of conduction state that the rate of heat flow by conduction in a given direction is proportional to the area perpendicular to the direction of heat transfer and the temperature gradient in that direction. So this is the definition of Fourier's law of thermal conduction. Rate of heat flow is always perpendicular to the direction of heat transfer and multiplied by the temperature gradient, and it is given by the equation Q is equal to minus Ka dT by dx. I represented with a small graph to the right of the to right side of this slide, that is temperature versus the x coordinate. Y coordinate is temperature, x coordinate is the thickness of the wall or the radius of the cylinder or the radius of the sphere that you are going to consider like that. Okay, Q is the rate of heat transfer in watts and K is the thermal conductivity in watt per meter degree Celsius. I am here with appealing to all the students that units, whatever the specific quantity in an equation you are writing, you should know the unit for all those quantities, all those variables you call it as. Quantity, suppose Q is equal to minus Ka dT by dx, I have written what is Q, what is Ka, what is K, what is dT by dx, what is T again, what is x again, you know, why you have to differentiate this, how you have taken this dT by dx, all those things I am going to explain by using this slide. Okay, dT by dx is the slope of the graph which I have given here. So this is the dT by dx. So this is what I am going to, so no, I am sorry. This I am going to take here. This is the slope of decreasing gradient. Okay. You know that dT by dx is the dT and is dx, the slope of this graph. Okay. It is between T1 and T2. Temperature at this point is T1. So here it is T1. This is at T1 and this is at T2. This is T1. This surface temperature is T1. This surface temperature is T2. Slab of thickness L I have taken, that is dx. And temperature gradient across this wall is gt. It means what is the temperature at here? It is T2. What is the temperature at here? T1. So therefore T1 is higher, T2 is lower. Therefore T1 minus T2 divided by x is equal to 0 and x is equal to L. It means L minus 0. That is the value. In the above equation, the negative sign indicates that temperature decreases along the positive direction of the flow. It means the heat is flowing in positive direction. It means the temperature decreases as it flows over the length. It means it loses its property. So the thermal conductivity of metal can be expressed K is equal to Q by dT by dx, where Q is the heat transfer per unit area. That is, you call it as a flux. That is watt per meter square is the flux that you are going to. So these are the some of the assumptions which made. Thermal conductivity is highest value conducting pure metals, the lowest value for the gases and except the evacuated insulating system. Okay, so these are the some of the non solid liquid lies in the between them. However, the metallic crystal lies conductivity. It means so conductivity of the material K value has taken. These are the some of the properties of a different material, that is conductivity of different materials which I have given. The range of, sometimes he is going to ask the property material to write, and then you can write this graph and then show which one is having highest is silver, copper, the lowest is in that ferrometal, it is steel, and again sodium, liquid metals, oxides, water, fiber, gases, and also the insulating materials. These are the variations that I have given. Thermal conductivity of various engineering materials are as shown in figure. And left side is given the conductivity. Copper is having very high conductivity, and insulating material is having very, very low thermal conductivity. So the convection heat transfer. So the time is up now, I think. Time is up now. I am going to wind up. I am going to continue from the convection heat transfer in the next class. I am solving some few exam problems. Thank you very much.